on behalf of Minjil, our cultural group, just want to say congratulations to the artists. First of all, congratulations to Northside and the family and friends of everybody gathered here. We acknowledge Jufla, we acknowledge Jufla Elvis and your families from wherever you are from, near and far. And we want to extend our gratitude for the invitation here, that seeing that you have acknowledged us as the people custodians of this place here, Kimwibarra, which is the original name that the city of Cairns now lies upon. This area here, Kimwibarra, is home to many families. And we, Minjil, are here in representation of the tri-nations of this area. From Dabogandi to Yirindi to Kungandi to Mamu, we come here as one to represent our nations together and to say welcome to Cairns, welcome to Kimwibarra. Representative in Minjil to also extend as well.
Yorinyora, Guribuka Juno, Nau Jabagaji Bama, Nau Bulba, Nun Banja, Nau Yuba Jama, Minjil, Gugoy. I am Jabagai, also I am from Karanga, here on the behalf of Minjil, let's say thank you, on behalf of Minjil. Gugoy.
Good evening, my name is Jamin Drum. Language name is Gardner, Black Over 2. My father is from Kuruman Beach down in Innisfail, Mandabara Mo, and my mother is from Yindiji up here in Kimwibarra. I'd like to say thanks, especially everyone here that came for this occasion, and a big thank you from my family.
As part of the gratitude and thanks for being here, the invitation here, we would like to extend a thank with a couple of small gifts to the artists. So if the artists can please come forward, please.
Ashley Campbell. I'm the director of Northside Contemporary Arts, and I would also like to acknowledge this Gimoi country and pay my respects to elders past, present, and emerging of the Gimoi Wallabari Yidinchi Nation and the neighbouring nations, Jabagai, Bunganji, and as Carl said, extending out Mamu, Yolanji. We're very fortunate to be in this beautiful place in far north Queensland and be working with such special people, a strong connection to land, and so I pay my respects to elders past, present, and emerging. Thank you for coming here this evening for the opening of two very special exhibitions. I think we can all acknowledge that it's special to be coming together at the moment in this way. We have a number of artists that have been able to travel to be here with us this evening. Freya Carmichael and her mother Sonia for representing the artists of the Longwater Fibre Stories exhibition, and also Lenore Howard. So I would like to introduce Freya to you this evening. Freya's an incredible curator with lots of connections and really specialising in weaving practice and fibre work. This exhibition, Longwater Fibre Stories, has been presented at the Institute of Modern Art, and Freya and Sonia recently launched it up in Nilangimbi. So we're the second space that the exhibition is able to travel to. And as Freya will explain, it contains a number of works by artists from this North region. So I'd like to welcome Freya to the microphone. To return the artworks back
to country and for the artists to show the exhibition in the context of their community and within their cultural spaces. And that was the first time an exhibition had ever returned there. So I really want to thank the people behind the exhibition tour, the IMA staff, Nick and Museum and Gallery Services Queensland that have put so much care into helping bring the exhibition back onto the communities of where the artists represent. And I think that is so important right now that we can still keep connected and through warm water, it'll keep travelling. The next stop is up into Gatatui and the Torres Strait Islands, and then returning over to Darwin and then further down south. So as it keeps travelling, it collects the stories from country as well of the places that it moves through. And I'd also just like to acknowledge the support of Australia Council too. With their support, I was able to put together a publication that goes with the exhibition, and that's also an important project in itself alongside the exhibition. Working with Larrakia artist and designer Jenna Lee, and you can bear incredible poet and writer Ellen Van Neven, who visited the exhibition and wrote responsive poetry to the works. And also, there's a lot of interviews and stories with the artist's own voices. So I think that's all the thank yous. And I just want to thank you all for being here. And
experience. dates historically back to the early bush trips the family had, that Lenore historically went handy with the family, but more recently she's been out with Kerry Trutman experimenting with lots of tactile elements in the bush, ready materials, dirt, rock, charcoal from the fire and textures from tree bark, dirt and colours in it. And what's interesting is that these kind of trips out to the bush have actually influenced some of these works because of the random and surprising visual and sensual connections that you see in the works, the pressures and convolutions of nature. What's interesting about Lenore's process and her work is her openness. She's actually completely open when she goes to the site. I think this is something that artists and writers do. They are completely open to what is there rather than kind of have this preconception about what they're going to produce. They let the site or the circumstance speak to them. And I think that's kind of very evident in the way that Lenore's kind of progress out of probably this earlier work that she used to do with those more surrealistic paintings to the more abstract work that she did in 2008 and today to these works, which have kind of really taken a life of their own, and they have almost played a game between form and space. There's not a, there's not a predictable notion of painting in these works as there was in the prior works. What's interesting about the bush too was the spatial references. There were visual points of tension, the improbable connections, soft and hard, sharp and diffused. And the other thing is that nature is confounding. You know, we're kind of used to, I think, using our conceptual, we use our brains more than we use our intuition and our kind of heartfelt sense. And I think Lenore shows us up a bit with this, because I feel that Lenore has got that heartfelt connection with both the materials and the mediums and techniques, but also the visual references she uses, like the bush. She kind of looks for those things. I have just about Lenore's approach, I have a visual recollection of her rolling around in the sand at the last book haul of the Running Tribe workshops, with Susan Doherty rapidly drawing outlines as she went. And I thought, well, this is very Lenore, you know, that she would get right down and experience the earth in that particular way. And I'll just have a hurried reference here. All of the Running Tide is on this weekend, up until Monday. Lenore's work is not conceptual or scientific, but arrives from a deeper place, from intuition, and a sophisticated aesthetic, a visual literacy developed over a lifetime of engaging in this exploratory way with her art practice through materials, mediums, and techniques. And I think what was interesting, if you think about that early North Queensland surrealist phase that she had, often kind of psychological revelations through carefully rendered works, but these were full of contradictions and unexpected interactions in the same way as these current works. Lenore's work could be described as confounding, the opposite to a thesis where a theory is proposed to be maintained or proved. And the word confounded is used when research deviates from the expected outcome. Lenore's art is determinedly confounding, pursuing the vital deviation rather than the predictable outcome. An approach that requires courage because you don't know where you'll end up. It is alternately unpredictable and can evoke doubt and involves continual adjustment and readjustment. And I think Lenore showed that kind of, insecurity sometimes that comes from developing work from that more intuitive sense that her work is definitely coming from. For me, the approach has similarities with the Buddhist understanding of no mind consciousness, where the mind is bypassed and the artist engages with the unknown, a place which also resonates beyond words with the viewer. This exhibition will take you where you're not expecting to go, through the tunnel of Lenore's experience into surprising and delightful spatial expressions, between form and formlessness, into artworks that will delight and entice. It gives me great pleasure to open this outstanding exhibition. Thank you, Lenore.
Thank you very much, Jill. Now, Lenore, would you like to come up and say a few words? Unexpectedly, two works emerged that I feel reflect my former surrealist era, as there is a hint of a perspective space in there, and I'm actually standing in front of them, so these two here. In a different way, this unconscious relationship to something manifests in the series of works on paper, created when camping in remote bush locations. These operate at an ethereal level and must intuitively reference an experience. When I'm out there, the sensation of freedom and space is palpable. And it's such a contrast from my hypercritical headspace and processes in the studio. I continually ask myself to trust and allow. In the studio, excitement comes from multiple processes that generate spontaneous reveals, such as paint being applied over areas and removed through a variety of tools, such as scrapers or forcefully with an electric sander. I also employ time-honored methods that any 2D painter uses in having a discourse with the surface. However, as a pure abstract painter, there is no clear signpost offering direction at any given moment, even when accompanied with a knowledge of values, composition, and colour. Many times I fail, and fail repeatedly, and this can challenge confidence and create acute vulnerability. But risk-taking and curiosity are core components of how I operate. This exhibition contains many elements of exploration, many of which ended up as total shipwrecks. And nothing is ever lost. I love this quote, "Searching for the unknown eliminates regret." And unfortunately, cannot give you the author's name. Which is all very well, but 2.5 years ago, I thought it would be fun to get my hands dirty and with pure naivety, and I'm looking at them right now, dived into the supreme complexity of ceramics. Once again, there were plenty of disasters along the way, but 5 raku pieces survived for this exhibition out of about, what we were saying before, really, 14 or something?
Many.
Despite the many frustrations, a mitigated joy emerges when the fundamentals in any medium coalesces in ways that could not be predicted. In reference to these major paintings, irregular shapes first emerged around 2009. These developed into an architectural configuration
that presented startling engagements for new compositions, while most importantly, extending into the space beyond those edges. Elements of energy and tension translated into a relationship between gravity and elevation. It was only in the last few months that I was surprised by the extent which this developed and redefined my perception of what is possible with the emergence of sculptural components. Throughout it all, I trust that a work carries a palpable integrity of intention, and while this means different things for different artists, it is often only revealed through time. Okay, I can relax now because this is the fun bit. It's been a very intense 9 years since my last mini solo exhibition, and there are many people whom I now wish to acknowledge, for I would not be here without them, and hope that you'd hold it in full blast there. It's going to take a little while. But please give me your attention for this moment. So Northside. About 2 years ago, I asked Ashley if she would care to review what I was developing. It had been so long since showing any work, I wasn't sure if she was even aware of my exhibiting history. Ashley was supportive from the very first experience, and I have totally appreciated the safety and support provided by her wisdom, advanced artistic awareness, and capacity for practical solutions which has steered this complicated exhibition. Her vision leading up to it and on site in relation to placement of the paintings, works on paper, and ceramics elevates the show, and I could not be more ecstatic. I also thank Mikhail Marzik, who I see is down there, who was very helpful during his tenure this year as acting director while Ashley was on maternity leave. He also beautifully and professionally photographed all these works. For many reasons, over the past couple of years, Northside was presented with quite difficult scenarios. The organisation is under the quite difficult scenarios through pandemics, etc. To my fellow artists, I wish to state this as clearly as possible. The organisation is under the steerage of a phenomenal director in Ashley and a dynamic board of directors with Michael Cosgrove as chair. And I believe it will go places that we could only have dreamt of as a fledgling organisation nearly 30 years ago. Much kudos to those who kept it operational in the past. I was a original member of Kick Arts, actually, all those years ago. Now, Lou Derry, where's Lou? His cutout shapes is going to be a nightmare. And Ashley coordinated with Lou Derry, well known to you through her stunning landscape paintings. She travelled to my home over 2 full days and attached the D-rings. They're the things that go on the back of paintings, right? To help me up there. Lou is an extremely experienced exhibitions installer, yet these shapes did both her head in and mine. Especially when we flipped the works and everything lost its bearings. Fortunately, we could laugh at our unintentional yoga maneuvers across the kitchen floor. She also joined the team here at Northside for 2 crucial days, and I do not know how Lou and Rosie Miller analysed where to place the screws in the wall so the work could be placed with precision. Aidan Noah Jr. gave the finishing touches to the install, and my heartfelt appreciation to the rest of the team, Rebecca, Lauren, Jamalia, Jamie and Aisha, who meet every challenge behind the scenes or front of the house. Now, they say it takes a village to raise a child. Well, it took a city to action beyond the sight of land. There is perhaps only one person in this room more relieved than I that the work made it safely into the gallery, and that is my mother, Ruby Howard. Ruby turned
this opportunity to make yourself known to her. Thanks, Mum. 2020 was a serious artist block for me. Last year in November, my dear sister Denise, put your hand up, there she is, Jackie Joy, and her husband Darren McNeil, and their three elderly rescue dogs drove from Brisbane to Cairns and took care of the household for a month. Their caring capacity includes Daryl being a migration advisor who is currently assisting desperate people seeking humanitarian visas stemming from the Afghanistan crisis.
Wow.
So that's what he does, right?
Yeah.
Therese Formanowski. Now, I haven't seen Therese here tonight, has she? Therese. What? Don't tell me she's not here, I can't believe it. My mother considers Therese a third daughter, as she has looked after Mum on numerous occasions. In the weeks leading up to transporting the works here, she stayed several times overnight, working all day and into the evening, guiding and assisting me when joining the pieces, plus being involved in the arduous task of packing. Her cheeky sense of humour kept me on track too. In addition, a big shout out to Jan Graham, who's not here tonight, who helped me with the structures in the early stages. Now, Lindsay Armand, I know Lindsay's around. Where's Lindsay? There she is. Lindsay is one of my oldest friends. In the real world, she is a manager, currently on long service leave. I suspect she took this as she had a premonition I'd be sending out an SOS and came for two long days, and we'd still be packing if not for her assistance. Just made it in time prior to Stefan Geisler, who's over there at the back thinking it's going to who postponed essential things in his life to collect the exhibition and drive the hire man, the slowest he said he has ever done, from Redmond to Albion, groaning with every little bump. Apparently there was the longest trail of vehicles behind him. Big acknowledgement too to Deborah Lawson, a close friend and provider of crack and back, for the myriad ways in which she has kept me going over the years in body and spirit. I know she's
here. Here I am.
3 weeks ago, I thought I may have a virus on my computer at the worst possible time. Can you imagine that? Thank you to my son-in-law, Zach Donahue, for taking care of it and bringing my stress levels down to a manageable level. So Susan Reed just appeared before. Now, many of you would know Susan. Susan and I shared a house for a couple of years and never a cross word was spoken. I am privileged to observe her professional journey over the years through various incarnations, and she operates as a high-level artist with a brilliant mind. Thank you, Sue, for your beautiful essay that had me looking at my own work differently. There she is. The tape team. Now, here we go. Hiding behind that pillar's not going to help you get it up. As most of you know, I taught art at the Tropical North Institute of TAFE, but decided to return as a student. Oh great, they cried. Howard is coming back to TAFE and going to try ceramics. That is until I turned up. And on the first day, Jenny Valmadre, the head ceramics teacher and experimental artist whom I totally respect, and I'm very proud of her creations tonight, tried to guide me in the basics. One has to start somewhere, all right? Trying to shook my head. No, that doesn't interest me. Which became the constant refrain. Yes, I know, a right pain. But hopefully a few laughs along the way. We got there in the end.
You were fantastic.
And you'll be very pleased to know I'm coming back next year. Olivia has a party. I saw her tonight. He's a technical visitor and also conducts classes in the ceramics department and already has a strong artistic voice. She was instrumental in firing all my pieces, including the raku, which are on the other side of that wall, plus throwing the black vessels that uphold the white textured porcelain shapes found in the shop and expertly assembled by my go-to handyman, Mark Boyle. So you tell me my mentions. We're nearly there, guys, isn't it? a big thank you to German-trained cabinet maker Gertrude Ehrman, whom I hope she's watching tonight, who brought all her expertise to make each stand fit the individual ceramic shapes, and I hope you're watching tonight. Rose Wrigley's let me know tonight she couldn't make it because she's not feeling well. Is a thoughtful and multi-skilled artist who also teaches at TAFE and on venturing into the world of printing and monotypes, I was given the benefit of her vast experience. Lenore Flinders and Aroma Mix, I have permission to mention his name, contributed their thoughts on technique in this area and all was much appreciated. I have felt exceptionally supported by the whole TAFE team and encourage future students to venture forth. Okay, Kerry Trapnell. Kerry Trapnell is a renowned photographer who has spent over 30 years working far north Queensland and particularly the Cape. We are close friends and constantly aim to outdo the level of cheekiness. he wins. He kindly took me out bush and my three conditions for the latest trip in April were a real fire, running water, and no crocodiles. After emerging from a swim in the Ross River, I overheard him speaking to good friend and fellow photographer Paul Curtis that it was surprising more crocodiles weren't evident up there. Now, I don't know if he was serious or not. Kerry, Paul, and their third photographer mate, Stephen Alkowski, have kindly welcomed me into the edge of their group. I refer to them as the Three Musketeers, which means I must be, I'm not sure if I pronounce this right, D'Artagnan, or the Camp Cook. And at last, to my dear friend Jill Chisholm. Jill doesn't really need an introduction, as she's so well known, especially after just creating another curatorial tour de force with the group show Call of the Running Tide. I saw it last week in Port Douglas and highly recommend a visit before it's dismantled. Jill operates with the highest integrity at all times, which I value and respect. And thank you for your continuous support, honest feedback, and clear thinking that has assisted me immeasurably behind the scenes and for being here tonight and opening this exhibition. And thank you all very much for coming. I'm so pleased that you could make it. And that's the end. Where's champagne?
That's it from us. Most